So now that it is already 5 o'clock and we should be in time. So again, officially welcome Mr. Sharvil Majmudar. I'm sorry, sir, because I come from Bengal and we have a similar, surname,
yes,
which is
yes.
Majumdar. So I keep on, yeah. Anyway, sir, a very warm welcome. And my dear students, let me introduce, sir. Sir had been practicing advocate in Gujarat High Court for more than 15 to 16 years. And sir specializes on commercial laws, on also on international law also. And sir has done his CA and LLB. And in today's session, sir will be discussing about force majeure or act of God during this pandemic situation. And we all know that this is an act of God. So we all remember the movie called Oh My God. And this is a time that is Oh My God, and what to do with our contracts, what to do with our agreements, etc. So without taking much time, sir, I leave the platform to you. Kindly enlighten us and also the students. And all students, kindly mute your microphone so that we can hear, sir. And then at the end of 30 to 40 minutes time, we can take up the question answer session if the students would like to ask any questions. And I would encourage the students to ask as many questions as possible to sir, so that sir can make all of us understand exactly what is the situation, how to do the legal recourse, etc. So sir, welcome here.
Thank you. Thank you for a very generous introduction. Friends, as we know, right now we are combating very tough times. We are all facing the wrath of COVID. However, every cloud has a silver lining. The topic which I have been given today is force majeure. It is a very complex and a lengthy topic. However, I'll be covering the main issues like a friend answer chop who covers the main issues without going deep into the subject because of paucity of time. I have divided this topic into four portions. The first is the statutory context in which this doctrine applies. The second is the case law context or the judgments which are applicable to it. The third, which I would deal with today, is the third portion is that in what manner will force majeure be applicable in COVID? And lastly, what is the effect of labor contract or wages as far as force majeure is concerned? So friends, let us first start with the first portion, which is the statutory context of force majeure. Force majeure is a part of the Contract Act or the principles which are enshrined under the Contract Act. There are two major provisions of law which we need to understand for this. The first is Section 32 of the Contract Act. Section 32 of the Contract Act deals with contingent contracts. It says that contracts which become subsequently impossible to perform because of some contingency are void contracts. So a contingent contract which is based upon some contingency which becomes impossible to perform in future is a void contract. If I can give an example, if A and B enter into a contract that A will supply goods to B provided B marries C, and C and B does not marry C at all, then the contract of A to supply goods to B is frustrated. Remember friends, force majeure is ultimately a doctrine of frustration of contract, how a party gets discharged from performing the contract. So the first statutory provision is Section 32 of the Contract Act. The second statutory provision which is important is Section 56 of the Contract Act. Section 56 of the Contract Act says that certain agreements or contracts to do impossible acts are void. So for example, if parties enter into a contract to cure something by magic, then that contract is void and such contracts need not be performed. So Section 32 and 56 are the two main statutory context under which we get some more clarity about the doctrine of force majeure. the case laws which there are large number of case laws on this topic. However, I would be covering four major case laws. The first is 1954 judgment.
Sir, microphone has been muted.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So, as far as case law context is concerned, there are four major case laws. There are large number of case laws on this. Because of the paucity of time, I would be covering four major case laws. The first is 1954 judgment of Bangad, which is a judgment given by Justice B.K. Mukherjee, Supreme Court judgment. The second is 1960 judgment of Alopi Prasad, judgment of Justice Deshi Shah, again a Supreme Court judgment. Third is 1968 judgment of Justice Nihati, which is a judgment given by Justice Shelan. And the last is a recent judgment of 2017 of Energy Watchdog, which is a judgment given by Justice Nariman. So, friends, let us first understand the difference between vis major and force major. Vis major is a Latin term, force major is a French term. Vis major means act of God, like earthquake, flood, etc., tsunami. Force major means act of God as well as some man-made act which renders performance of the contract impossible. So, force major is not merely an act of God, it is an act of God, but it also includes certain man-made acts because of which the performance of the contract gets frustrated. So, you can say that vis major is a subset of force major. Force major is a wider term, vis major is a narrower term. However, as popularly known, force major is an act of God. However, legally, it means an act of God plus certain man-made acts or events which renders the performance of the contract impossible. This is a concept of under the English law, which is the Contract Act, is a codified law. It is a very good piece of legislation, and as we all know, it has been adopted by us from the British, and we are still following it. But it is an excellent piece of legislation, which even today holds good. There are around 400 years of English jurisprudence and 70 years of Indian case laws. So, as far as force major is concerned, there is a deep sea in which you can dig deep. However, we will be covering the main principles and the concepts. So, friends, frustration of contract is basically, as far as case laws goes, it can be culled out from three things. One is the presumed intention of parties. So, if the court feels that this was the presumed intention of parties for performing the contract, and that presumed intention of parties is now not possible to be adhered to, the contract can be frustrated. The second is not the presumed intention of parties. However, the standard which the court applies is the test of reasonable man. That is, if a reasonable man is able to perform a contract, doctrine of frustration will not apply. However, because of some supervening events, the reasonable man is not able to perform the contract, the doctrine of frustration of contract would be applicable. And the third is sometimes to apply the judge's perception. So, sometimes if the judge feels that for doing justice, I would apply the doctrine of frustration, then that is called applying the judge's perception. In my view, friends, the courts should ordinarily be guided by the second principle, which is the principle to apply the test of a reasonable man, because applying judge's perception would lead to uncertainty. Each judge may have his own view. Applying presumed intention test would also be too vague. There would be lack of clarity. So, it would be better if the courts go by the test of a reasonable man or the reasonableness test. As I said, section 32 is somewhat like implied intention of parties, and section 56 of Contract Act is like a reasonable test application. If I can give a direct example of frustration of a contract or force major, is that if on a given day a music event is planned, and say on Sunday tomorrow, a music event is planned at a hall, and the hall gets burnt. Then the contract gets frustrated. The parties are not bound to perform a contract because the hall or the event which was going to take at a particular place has got burnt. So it is now impossible to perform the event tomorrow. So these are some basic illustrations. You would also find these illustrations under section 32 as well as section 56 of the Contract Act. However, for applying the doctrine of force majeure, that is frustration of contract, the courts have always held a very high threshold, a very high burden of proof on parties who are asserting the doctrine of force majeure. Judges have held that a plea of force majeure is applicable if it upsets the very foundation of the contract. It is like a discharge of a contract, as I said. There are various modes of discharge of a contract. A contract can also be discharged by performance. However, contract can also be discharged if it is frustrated. So, doctrine of frustration of contract or force majeure is also a mode of discharge of the contract. The courts have gone to the extent of saying that it should be of such nature which would radically change the contract. It is something which the parties had never contemplated, and an event has occurred which makes it completely impossible for the parties to perform the contract. There should be an act of permanence in it. If it is of temporary nature, then doctrine of force majeure is not applicable. If the difficulty in performing the contract is temporary, then this doctrine will not be applied. The act, the subsequent event should be such which is of permanent nature, which radically changes the contract. It is like a contract of crow becomes a contract of swan, something like that. Radically changes the contract with the parties that never envisages. In such cases, the doctrine of frustration would be applicable. The courts have said that it must destroy the underlying basis of the contract. So the whole underlying basis of the contract would be destroyed by the subsequent event. Only then the doctrine of frustration would be applicable. The courts have time and again held, this is very important, that doctrine of frustration is not a technique to absolve a party from performing his contract. So a party cannot say that now the prices have risen, I will not be able to perform my contract, so please apply the doctrine of force majeure and relieve me from performance of the contract. So that is not permissible. So it is not a technique by which a party can commit breach of the contract. So that is very important. You cannot think of committing breach of the contract, or you cannot wriggle out of the terms of the contract by saying that the subsequent event was not envisaged, and therefore please apply the doctrine of force majeure. The courts have said no, that will not be permissible. The courts have said that change in currency, change in price rise are not grounds to apply the doctrine of force majeure. You still have to perform the contract. The burden of proof is very high on a party who raises the plea of force majeure. So if I go to the court saying that, sir, I had entered into a contract, however, because of this particular situation, I have not been able to perform the contract, like riots or curfew, etc. The court would put a very high burden on me that the event is such as it would render impossible for me to perform the contract. And the event has to be a...
I'll take 1 minute, sir. Some please. Students are probably having some connection problem. I hope all participants can hear, sir. I hope all participants can hear, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Sir, please continue, because only one participant probably was having some problem. Sir, yes, sir. Sir, please continue, sir. Sorry for the...
No, that's all. So I should continue, right?
Yes.
Thank you. So the conclusion based on various case laws is that it is a very high burden on the person who asserts the plea of force majeure. A person who goes to the court saying that relieve me from the contract by applying the doctrine of force majeure or frustration of contract is put at a very high threshold, and only in circumstances where the court feels that the event would radically change the contract, the court has accepted the plea of force majeure. Now, these were the statutory contexts. Now, coming to the case law context, As I said, I would discuss four case laws shortly, briefly. The first is the 1954 judgment, which is called Bangard's case, judgment of Supreme Court. This was a case where the developer or the builder had to build a flat and give it to his customers. However, due to war, the judgment came in 1954. The dispute was at the time of the Second World War. Because of the Second World War, that land over which the flats were to be constructed were requisitioned by the central government. It means the land was for a temporary period taken by the central government. So the builder then told his customers that, look, the land has for 3 years been requisitioned by the central government. I will not be able to now build the flats. Take back your money and go back. The customers went to the court and said that the builder is duty bound to perform his contract. He cannot wriggle out of this. The builder raised the plea of force majeure. He said that I was ready to perform the contract. I was ready to build the flats. However, the central government has taken the land for 3 years. So it is not economically feasible for me to now build the flats here. So applying the doctrine of force majeure, I should be relieved from performing my contract. The Supreme Court rejected the plea of force majeure. The Supreme Court said, firstly, that in the contract of the builder with the customers, there is no stipulation of force majeure. The contract does not contain a clause that because of any unforeseen event in future, either party would be able to wriggle out of the terms of the contract. The Honorable Supreme Court also said that requisition of the land of the builder by the government is for a temporary period. It is not permanently acquired. So if it was a case of permanent acquisition, maybe the builder would have got the benefit of force majeure. Our Supreme Court has said that since the land was only temporarily acquired, only for a period of 3 years, the builder could still thereafter construct the flats and give possession to the customers. So it gave the decree of specific performance to the customers and said that the plea or defense of force majeure raised by the builder is not acceptable. The second is a case, which is a case of 1960. Again, a case of Honorable Supreme Court, case of Alopi Prasad. Alopi Prasad was a person who was supplying ghee. He was supplying ghee to army. However, again, this is a case pertaining to Second World War. During declaration of Second World War, he said that now it is not possible for me to supply ghee to army camps. So please relieve me of my obligation. The case went up to the Honorable Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said that declaration of war again is not something which is permanent. It is temporary. It said that Mr. Alopi Prasad cannot wriggle out from the terms of the contract. He has to keep supply ghee, which was the contract, then he is committing breach of the terms of the contract and he is held liable for that. So friends, these are cases where even situations such as war is not considered to be a defense of force majeure. What I'm trying to say is, or the principles which are curled out from this is that a very high threshold is put by Honorable Supreme Court in order to raise the defense of force majeure. Firstly, the plea should be, one of the foremost thing is that the there should be a stipulation in the contract that in the event of some unforeseen event, the doctrine of force majeure should be applicable. Absent that stipulation, it is very, very difficult to raise the defense of force majeure. Despite which, in given circumstances, if the event is of permanent nature, if the disability is something which is radical, then the Supreme Court or the court would give the benefit of force majeure to the concerned party. However, the threshold is very high. The third case law is the case law of Nehati, which is 1968. This was a case of a jute supplier who entered into a contract to supply jute. However, his license to supply jute was cancelled in 1965. So he went to the court and said that relieve me from my obligation to supply jute because my license has been cancelled. Even in this case, the Supreme Court rejected his defense of force majeure and said that this is something which you could have envisaged before entering into a contract. You entered into a contract saying that you would be supplying jute. Subsequent to that, if your license gets cancelled, the other party is not at fault. You have entered into contract with open eyes. This situation of cancellation of your license cannot be termed as an event which will make it impossible for you to perform the contract as it was envisaged when the contract was entered into. So even in this case, the Honorable Supreme Court has rejected the doctrine of force majeure. And the last is a recent judgment of Energy Watchdog of the Honorable Supreme Court. That is 2017 judgment. It is a judgment of Justice Nariman. It is more based on commercial impossibility. Now, friends, if you recollect, I have just said that rise in price or rise in currency are not grounds to relieve a party from the obligations of the contract. In 2017 judgment, which was of Energy Watchdog, there was a contract to supply electricity. Various big corporates like Adani, Reliance had entered into contract with the Union of India to supply electricity. However, they were to procure coal from Indonesia and then convert it into electricity and supply it to the government. Due to change in laws in Indonesia, procurement of coal became impossible for them. And so they said, they pleaded force majeure. They said that the policies of Indonesia have changed. We cannot procure the coal at a price at which we had thought. So permit us to get relief from the contract, discharge this contract, apply the plea of force majeure. Justice Nariman very rightly says that firstly, the contract does not stipulate the source from which you have to get the electricity. You have thought it to fit to get coal from Indonesia, but it is not something which is contemplated in the contract. It is your problem if laws of Indonesia has changed. Doctrine of force majeure is not available here. This is merely a commercial impossibility, and in commercial impossibility, doctrine of force majeure is ordinarily never applied. So that plea was rejected, and those parties were held to be bound by the terms of the contract and the stipulations of the contract. So, friends, these are the 4 or 5 cases. In 2017 judgment of Energy Watchdog, Justice Nariman relies on a 1962 judgment of the Privy Council, the House of Lords, where it was a case that certain goods have to be supplied through shipping them from Suez Canal. However, the Suez Canal was subsequently closed. So the party went to the court in England and said that kindly apply the doctrine of force majeure. The Suez Canal is now closed. I cannot ship my goods through the Suez Canal. However, the court said that even if Suez Canal is closed, you can still go through Cape of Good Hope and supply the goods. So it is not, there is an alternate available to you to still perform your contract. And the court did not allow the plea of force majeure to stand. So even in cases where alternatively it is possible to perform the contract, the courts have rejected the plea of force majeure. As far as current situation is concerned now, which would be, all the friends would be interested in knowing the effect of force majeure in current situation, the current crisis, COVID. In my view, there is no doubt that COVID is an act of God. Coronavirus is an act of God. However, whether the doctrine of force majeure would be available to a party to the contract or not when it goes to the court of law is a completely different matter. Considering the case laws and the 2017 judgment, the answer would be that a party will not be able to wriggle out of the obligations of the contract even during COVID by saying that there is COVID and it is act of God and I am unable to perform my contract. However, there are some exceptions to that, which I'll just say. So let us just take 2-3 examples like tenant-landlord case. Whether the tenant can say that because of COVID, I will not be able to pay rent to the landlord. The answer is no. The tenant cannot say that because of COVID, I will not be able to pay the rent to the landlord. It is a different matter. See, here we are talking purely in legal terms. It is a different matter if parties negotiate and as a matter of a good gesture, the landlord says that all right, because of coronavirus, I will not take rent from you for 3 months or 4 months. That depends on negotiation of the parties. But today what I'm saying is purely in legal terms. In legal terms, it is not possible for a tenant to say that because of COVID, I will not pay rent, and therefore, due to this pandemic, apply the doctrine of force majeure. That will not be available if they go to a court of law. However, everything will still depend on the terms of the agreement. If by chance in the tenancy agreement it is written that if there is a pandemic, then the tenant does not have to pay rent, then the tenant may not be liable to pay rent. But I doubt whether there would be any such contract. Now, in future, I'm sure parties would take more care to see and include such stipulation in the contract that in case of pandemic, the party may be not bound to perform the contract during that stipulated period. However, prior to this, hardly I have seen any contract which have said that because of pandemic, the doctrine of force majeure would be applicable to parties and the parties will not be liable to perform the contract. So, absent that stipulation, it is difficult to take the plea of force majeure. Recently, I had read somewhere that ICICI Bank has 500 branches which are on rent. Most of the branches were closed due to lockdown. In good faith, the landlords of ICICI Bank can say that we will not take rent from you for 2-3 months. However, if the matter goes to the court of law, it would be difficult to succeed on the ground of force majeure, because as I said, there has to be something which is permanent as far as force majeure is concerned. We all know there was a lockdown for some time. However, there have been no relaxations, and lockdown per se would not be a ground for a party to wriggle out of the commitments of the contract. And even this pandemic, it's as of now, everybody says that it is not a permanent thing. So because of that, also it will not be possible for tenants or the lessees to get the benefit of force majeure. The next situation as far as COVID is concerned is that of wages. What happens to laborers, workers, dues of workmen, etc.? So that again, friends, would depend on the terms of the contract. Nowadays, in our country, mostly we have contractual labor. So it would depend on the terms of the contract. Even otherwise, there will be no frustration. The employer would be liable to pay wages to the workmen. Our government, under the Disaster Management Act, has also issued a notification which says that the management must continue to pay wages to the workmen. So that is again a force of law. It is a notification issued under the Disaster Management Act. So again, the doctrine of force majeure will not be applicable in this case to the employer. So as far as wages situation is concerned, the law is in favor of the employee, and the employer will not be able to take the benefit of force majeure. Friends, that brings me to one Chinese case. It is the case of Hong Kong, because since the facts were very similar, I was tempted to include that in today's discussion. It was a situation, because if you recollect, friends, in Hong Kong also, English law is applicable, as our contract is also based on it is authored by Britishers. Similar is the case in Hong Kong. So this was a case of 2003 SARS epidemic. The tenant had leased a property for 2 years. But immediately after he had entered into the lease agreement, SARS was declared. It was an epidemic and he could not use the property. So he moved out to some other place. Somebody in his in the neighbors of that property had been infected. He moved out to the other place. And thereafter, the landlord sued him for the recovery of the rent. The tenant raised the defense of force majeure. He said that because of SARS epidemic, I cannot occupy that property. If I cannot occupy that property, I should not be liable to pay rent. The court held no frustration. And the court mainly relied that the terms of the contract do not envisage that a party would be discharged from performing the contract in case of a pandemic. So what COVID teaches us is that in future, when you draft a contract, you should specifically include a clause that in case of pandemics or epidemic, the party may not be held liable to perform the contract, at least during the period during which the pandemic is in force. So if a party had a foresight in today to include such a term in the contract, maybe the parties would be discharged from performing the part of the contract by taking recourse to that clause, which would be a force majeure plea to the party. However, it is almost impossible for a party to have earlier predicted that there would be a pandemic of this nature, and therefore most of the contracts you will see do not have such clauses. As you know, friends, that Honorable Supreme Court has also now given some relaxations as far as procedural aspects are concerned. It has said that the law of limitation will get extended during the period during which the lockdowns are there or the pandemic is in operation. So those are procedure relaxations given. It is again not a part of force majeure, but it is something which is related to COVID. So I just brought it in the discussion. There is another side topic, which is material adverse effect, which is more applicable in US courts. It is not like force majeure, but something similar. Sometimes parties, particularly in mergers and acquisitions, have a clause that because of some unforeseen price rise or change in currency, etc., it is not possible to go ahead with signing of the agreement. Then they term it as a material adverse effect on the agreement. So this material adverse effect clause sometimes is found in agreements. As I said, this is a clause which is mostly applied in US courts, and it is based on merger. It is mainly applicable in mergers, acquisitions, etc. It is a very complex topic in itself, so I'm not dealing with it in detail. Another situation as far as COVID is concerned, as far as force majeure clause in COVID is concerned, is for maintenance contract. I mean, for example, if you have a maintenance contract of your air condition, and during the lockdown period, the person is not able to come to your house to service your air condition. In such a case, it can be argued that during that two or three months when the lockdown was in force, the benefit of force majeure would be available to that person because he is unable to come to your house to service the AC, to repair the AC. So he can plead the he can plead force majeure in such a case, but that too for a limited period. He cannot say that now I am completely relieved and even after the lockdown goes, the pandemic goes, I will still not be coming to service the air condition. That is not a defense which is available to him. Only during the period, limited period during which the pandemic is there, he can probably say that I should be discharged from performing the contract during that period. So that are those are some rare cases where during limited period, the courts may give you the benefit of force majeure. Otherwise, as I said, the terms of the contract are supreme and the terms of the contract have to be strictly followed. Recently, our government has laid down certain guidelines which says that for insurance contract, force majeure clause is not applicable. RBI has said that it will give moratorium period to its borrowers, but to the borrowers of the banks. However, it should not be termed as giving a relief of force majeure. So RBI is very clear. It says that we will for 6 months, we will not for some period, the banks may not initiate recovery proceedings against the borrowers who have committed default in repayment. However, it should not be termed as a force majeure relief. However, government has said that for supply chains, benefit of force majeure should be given. So, as far as India is concerned, the benefit of force majeure is to be given only to supply chains. Otherwise, it is not to be given for insurance contract. It is not to be given even in financial arrangements with the banks. There is a recent judgment of the Honorable Delhi High Court, which I think came only before 2 days. It is a judgment on force majeure 2020 judgment. It is in the case of Halliburton versus Vedanta Limited, where Justice Pratibha Singh has said, this is what she has said, I will just read. It says, there is no doubt that COVID-19 is a force majeure event. But was this event the cause of non-performance? Then the court further holds that the question as to whether COVID-19 would justify non-performance or breach of a contract has to be examined on facts and circumstances of each case. Every breach or non-performance cannot be justified or excused merely on invocation of COVID-19. The court further noted that the following would be important: the conduct of parties prior to outbreak, the deadlines that were imposed in the contract, the steps that were to be taken, various compliances that were to be made, and only then it can assess whether genuinely a party was prevented or is able to justify its non-performance due to epidemic or pandemic. The court further observes that the question whether COVID-19 would justify non-performance has to be examined on facts of each case, and it further says that in the facts of that case, the court says that the past non-performance of contractor cannot be condoned due to COVID-19 lockdown in March 2020 in India. The contractor was in breach since September 2019 and opportunities were given him to cure the same repeatedly, and the outbreak of a pandemic cannot be used as an excuse for non-performance of a contract for which deadlines were much before the outbreak itself. So friends, as I just to conclude, the burden is very high on the person asserting the plea of force majeure. If the benefit of force majeure would ordinarily be given only if there is a stipulation to that effect in the contract, absent that stipulation, it is very difficult for a person to get the relief of force majeure. However, it all depends on facts and circumstances of each case. Sometimes the judges also, in order to do balance the equities or to do complete justice, may give you a relief of force majeure. Legally, it is very difficult, and this is how the law has developed over a period of time in our country. So almost I have consumed 37-38 minutes. So I would look forward for questions from you if there are any. And otherwise, I hope this short discussion on this topic, which only gives a cursory view of the subject, has been of some help to you.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. So now it is open to the students. If you have any questions, you can ask. If you want, you can unmute your microphones, and you can ask sir any questions if you have, or you can also put it in the chat box so that sir can see. Sagar and Arpana, if you are there, kindly help.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
So my name is Smith Patel, and first of all, thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for the wonderful set of knowledge. And I want to ask one question, sir, that this is the time of pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic. And if two parties are entering into one lease agreement or any other agreement, as of now, and the force majeure is mentioned in that agreement, that the ground of termination of deed, and will, like, if the pandemic, like COVID-19 pandemic, continues for a period of like more 6 months, then after term of 5 months, will it be the ground of termination on the basis of force majeure, because two parties are entering at present?
Yes. If there is a stipulation in the contract that because of a declaration of pandemic in future, the party would be relieved from performing the terms of the contract, then the benefit of force majeure clause would be available even to the tenant. He can say that we had clearly agreed that in future, if there is a pandemic, I will not pay rent. So if there is a stipulation in the contract, the stipulation in contract will govern. That is the first principle. The second principle is that if there is no such stipulation, then as the law stands, the parties are not relieved from performing the contract, particularly in lease agreements. The lessor and lessee both are bound to perform their part of the agreement, even in case of a pandemic like COVID-19. So I think that might answer your question.
Sir, the thing is, it is stipulated in the lease agreement, but the two parties are entering into the agreement in during the time of pandemic. So, sir, okay. The question is, if they're entering during the time of pandemic, will that pandemic time period will also be like considered for ground of termination?
If they are entering in the, for example, from what you say, I understand that during the ongoing pandemic, the parties are entering into a lease agreement.
Yes, sir.
If in the lease agreement, that they make a stipulation that as long as this pandemic is in force, or as long as the declaration of pandemic by WHO continues, the parties would not be performing their contract, then the benefit of force majeure clause is available to the tenant or the landlord, as the case may be. However, it would depend on the stipulation made in the contract. If today they are entering into a contract, it would be wise to have a stipulation that as long as the pandemic continues, the parties should not be bound to continue to perform their obligations. However, then it may dissuade parties from entering into contracts. So ultimately, a middle way will have to be found out so that both the lessor and the lessee are comfortable. Because if you put a blanket clause that as long as the pandemic continues, the tenant will not pay rent, the landlord would not like to enter into a contract. So maybe such things would have to be worked out on negotiating table. However, if there is a clause, the parties are relieved from performing the contract. Absent that clause, parties have to perform the contract.
Okay, sir. But the thing is, the clause is only like, it's not specifying COVID-19 pandemic laws, but it's just specifying the pandemic, word pandemic, in the force majeure clause.
That's enough, because COVID-19 is a pandemic. So if you have the foresight to write the word pandemic, then you are safe. You can take the benefit of force majeure clause, force majeure doctrine.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, there was one more question coming up. I think it is from Khushali Vyas. So, Khushali was asking for any example of this force majeure and this pandemic situation right now. I mean, in this particular situation, is there any example that you can kindly share with us of such kinds of contracts?
Yes, I mean, example would be that, as I said, as I had given some examples during my speech, I said maintenance contracts, service contracts, they might be suspended for the period of lockdown or for the period during which it is not possible to perform. Mm-hmm. Like if there was a contract to exhibit a film in a cinema, however, most of the movie halls are closed. So such distributor agreements, etc., would automatically stand frustrated. It is impossible to perform them because of the restrictions of the government. So those are the cases where the doctrine of force majeure would be applicable, even if may not have been treated in or may not have been stipulated in the contract.
Right, sir. Right. Any other questions, students? Any more questions, students? Okay, sir. Yes, Shalav. Yes, please.
Thank you, sir, for sharing those wonderful case laws. Sir, my question is, what are the consequences of suspension of obligations upon occurrence of a force majeure agreement?
Sorry, can you repeat your question?
Sir, my question is, what are the consequences of suspension of obligations upon occurrence of a force majeure event?
The consequences would be that a party would be discharged from performing that his or her part of the contract during that period. So the period during which the disability continues, the party would not be liable to perform the contract or would not be sued for non-performance of contract. For example, as long as the lockdown continues, there are certain contracts which cannot be performed. So during that temporary period, the consequences would be that the party would be relieved from the obligations to perform the contract. However, if the contract is such which has got nothing to do with lockdown, then only the temporary period during which the party was unable to perform the contract would not help the party. The party would have to face all consequences of committing breach of the contract.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, I have one more question from a student. And
yes.
I'll read that question out, sir. A yes. has agreed to sell goods to B, and B has agreed to deliver it to C. Now, if the contract of A and B is frustrated due to pandemic, can B claim force majeure in the contract of B and C?
I doubt that B can claim force majeure. The reason is that I have quoted examples where even declaration of war has not been held to be a defense, and force majeure plea has been rejected by courts.
Okay, sir. Okay.
However, in the contract of B with C, if there is a stipulation, if it is a contingent contract, and if there is a stipulation that only if I get goods from A, I will supply goods to you, otherwise I will not supply goods to you, then it is squarely covered under Section 32 of the Contract Act, because the event becomes it is a contingent contract based on A supplying goods to B, and non-happening of that contingency would immediately make the subsequent contract void, or the subsequent contract would be frustrated. So it would still depend on the terms of the contract between B and C. And if it is a contingent contract, then the doctrine would be applicable.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Any other questions, students? Okay. So I don't see any other questions right now, but I'm damn sure that, sir, you'll be bombarded by me, by lots of questions from the students. Also, I'd request all the students, if you have any questions, you can share it with us, and we will be trying to give all the questions to sir. And sir, if you can kindly answer all these questions, because the students will be having more questions, they might not be asking it right now here. So anyway, sir, thank you so much from United World School of Law, and thank you for giving us your valuable time. With this, I end this so valuable session, because even I also learned so many things during this act of God. So thank you again, sir, and
thank you.
All students, thank you so much.
It has been my pleasure. Thank you. Yes. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir.
So I'll just leave the meeting, right?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.